The title of this short talk is for hip and knee replacement in fast track surgery. What do we change? Do we choose low molecular weight heparin, oral anticoagulants, direct oral anticoagulants, or aspirin? And in fact, as you said, the question was particularly discussed and debated last year because of the publication of the European guidelines on thromboprophylaxis. And as you see on the slides, on the if the patient has a high VTE risk procedure like knee replacement or hip replacement, with low VTE risk patient, which means that the patient has no history of VTE, no specific factors increasing the risk for VTE, the choice is given between low molecular weight heparin and or IPC, and an alternative for orthopedic surgery would be aspirin and or IPC. Why this change? If you remember, all the international guidelines and guidance documents were quite restrictive in the choice of the molecule. And up to 2012, aspirin was not recommended. And after that, beginning with guidelines from orthopedic surgery societies, only this group said that aspirin may be an alternative. The fact is that this change and this shift in protocol was primarily proposed in different studies. This is a typical study showing in a retrospective cohort here in knee surgery, comparing patients treated postoperatively with aspirin or anticoagulant. These kind of studies, observational studies, showed that the rate of pulmonary embolism or DVT was similar between groups, with a rate of bleeding that was comparable between groups, even if in this study there was a superiority, well, non-inferiority for both groups. And this is why aspirin was proposed. And you need to note that in these observational studies, here, this is an unadjusted analysis, the patient with a history of VTE was 3.1% in the aspirin group and was 6.8% in the anticoagulation group. So there is a lot of this kind of observational study, cohort studies with different methodologies. And the only randomized study that, in our opinion, is valuable in this discussion is this study, which is EPCAT-2. This is a multicenter double-blind randomized control trial in patients undergoing a knee surgery and hip surgery. And they were randomized between both arms were given rivaroxaban 10 milligram until post-op day 5, and then randomized between switch to aspirin or continuing with rivaroxaban. As you see, there is no difference in the rate of symptomatic event in VTE and major or any bleeding. And you need to note that in this study, the percentage of patients included in this study, there was only 2.4% of patients with a history of VTE. The time in the OR, the duration of surgery was quite short, and the length of stay in the hospital was 3.4 days. And in fact, if you compare the studies that introduced the direct oral anticoagulant between the year 2008 up to 2012, I picked up only three studies. The symptomatic events in the end were quite low, but at that time the length of stay was long, with in this study 12 days in the hospital, nine days, and in the studies comparing anticoagulant and aspirin, the length of stay was very short, 3.4 days here and 4.5 in EPCAT 1. So if we choose to administer aspirin in the post-operative period after a knee or hip replacement, we need to be cautious in the factor that will help for the choice, because we begin to have several cohort studies showing that there can be a difference in the rate of DVT. This paper showed that the rate of DVT was higher in outpatient as compared to inpatient procedures, showing that we need to check after the surgery that all the factors are ready to propose to the patient the treatment with aspirin. And as a conclusion, our group, our French group on hemostasis and perioperative hemostasis and bleeding, we choose to qualify aspirin for VT prevention after hip and knee replacement only if a fast-tracking program has three conditions: a short surgery, ambulation within 24 hours postoperatively, and a length of stay of less than 5 days. So my point is, yes, we can use aspirin, but we need to really select the patient to whom we will propose this strategy.
Thank you very much, Pierre, for your presentation. I'm a little bit puzzled by your data. So you demonstrated clearly that during the previous years, there's a new place for aspirin for a very specific population and specific conditions. However, regarding your data, could you comment on the quality of the evidence supporting the place of aspirin for hip replacement and knee replacement surgery?
This is a difficult question, and because all the arguments for aspirin come from mainly observational studies. There are several randomized studies, not exactly comparing the actual strategies, including anticoagulants, to aspirin. We picked up the most valuable evidence, which is not exactly aspirin versus anticoagulant, which is a sequential treatment, including a short treatment with anticoagulant and then extended anticoagulation with prophylactic doses with aspirin. So this is not aspirin versus anticoagulant. This is a different protocol for post-op, for the post-operative period. So my point, and this is the point that was chosen by the group, is that we would suggest to give a short period of anticoagulant after the surgery and then shift to aspirin. So the question, in fact, is not the place of aspirin. It's much more the duration of the treatment postoperatively. All the guidelines says 15 days or 40 days after knee surgery and 30 days after hip surgery. And perhaps the question is, can we shorten this this treatment, the duration of the treatment?
Okay, so this emerging option of sequential thromboprophylaxis with a few days of anticoagulant followed by a few days of aspirin is specific of hip and knee replacement surgery, or do you think we can recommend this sequential thromboprophylaxis also for indications such as hip fracture?
No, there is no data for hip fracture, and the circumstances of the surgery is not the same. So I should recommend to stick to the former recommendation, which means that we need to give anticoagulants postoperatively for 1 month after hip surgery for hip fracture. So we cannot extend this suggestion to other major orthopedic surgery.
Okay, so there is no place for sequential prophylaxis.
There is no data on that. There is no new literature on that. We should not change what we do now.
And can we use this option for hip revision or knee revision?
It's a difficult question. It depends on the type of revision. I would say that if revision is needed, this means that there is something happening, and probably this question is related to the fact that the patient is able to ambulate or not. But I would not give this protocol to a patient for knee or hip revision now.
Okay, so we have to, before prescribing the second-child prophylaxis, have a look to the thrombotic risk of the patients. We have to check that the patient will be in fast-track surgery. There is a recurrent question regarding the management of patients in the post-operative period, because usually after hip or knee replacement surgery, these patients have non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. Is there any concerns regarding the combination of these painkillers and aspirin in the post-operative period?
There is some literature saying that there is an interaction between aspirin and NSAIDs, which may bind to the COX-1 and hinder the effect of aspirin. So the question is, can we change that? I have not any data in mind showing that the, for example, giving the aspirin in the morning and the NSAID in the evening would affect the effect of aspirin to prevent VTE. So that's difficult to suggest to give NSAID in the post-operative period if you choose to give aspirin for VTE prevention. And I know that this is a real concern for orthopedics.
Yeah, because it will induce a strong restriction in the indication of aspirin in outpatient and fast-track surgery.
Yes.
I've just received a personal question. Dear Pierre, if you need hip replacement surgery, will you prefer aspirin or anticoagulant? I think it's a little bit private, but could you comment?
So this is a future case report, and I hope with a good outcome. Now, the fact is that there is a major shift in the way we prescribe VTE. When I have a major surgery, a high risk surgery, I know before surgery what kind of treatment I will give afterwards. But with these new guidelines, I will need to wait until I will be able to leave the hospital, because I will need to have three conditions. First, short surgery. We need to check that the surgery has been short. You need to check that you have been able to ambulate within the 24 hours postoperatively. And then that there has been no medical condition occurring in the early post-op period that will restrict ambulation or delay the hospital stay. So it depends on what happens during my surgery. I will choose a good surgeon, short surgery, do my best to walk within the 24 or 12 hours post-operatively, and be sure that I will not do any myocardial infarct or pneumonia after that. And this is a point that is very important. If the patient is an outpatient and has, for example, a condition that will push the patient to rest in bed, I will need to give him, again, anticoagulant to prevent VT prevention. But we will speak about that with Pierre Marerois, about the medical risk factors of those patients.
Thank you, Pierre.